Well, first of all, I want to say that it's such a pleasure to visit again with the Numberphile family. I haven't seen you guys in a long time, so hope you're doing well. I wanted to talk to you about something which I've been thinking about lately. And part of the reason is that I'm teaching this class at UC Berkeley, linear algebra. It has to do with numbers, because of course, you know, I love numbers. I do numbers for a living. I'm a mathematician, hello. And I know you guys also like numbers because, you know, we are watching Numberphile. But also being a mathematician, I think, I have a certain vantage point which sort of enables me to see, perhaps better than people who are not professional mathematicians, not only the uses of numbers, but also limitations of numbers. And this in particular, you know, I was interested in this as I was following a recent debate, which many of you may have seen play out in the media, about artificial intelligence. What do we mean by artificial intelligence? I mean, of course, we can mean many different things, but essentially we're talking about computers, right? We're talking about computers, we're talking about computer programs, we're talking about algorithms. How do they work? They work with numbers. To me, when people say that humans are just specialized computers and eventually we'll just build more and more powerful computers so that eventually they will surpass the power of a human, that kind of line of reasoning to me kind of betrays this idea that somehow a human is nothing but a machine. The human is nothing but a sequence of numbers. It is really something which lives and dies by numbers, you see. So that's why I'm not suggesting at all that there is nothing to math than numbers. Of course, there are many other things, right? So for example, there's geometry and so on. And in fact, I will demonstrate now, or I hope I will demonstrate, and that's my purpose, that in mathematics there are many things which we often confuse with numbers, but which are not actually numbers. Or they could be represented by numbers, but numbers do not really do justice to them. And so I would like to show you this one example, which came up in my linear algebra class. And this has to do with vectors. So look at this brown paper. So it is on this table, right? Imagine that it extends to infinity in all directions. So you can think of it as a two-dimensional vector space. Let me be a little bit more concrete. Let me pick a point. There we go. So this point will be the origin. This will be sort of like the zero point of this vector space, okay? And now I want to talk about vectors. And so a vector to me would be something like this. You see, it's an interval which has a length and a direction. And it starts at this origin, which I have fixed once and for all. This is fixed once and for all. Here is another example of a vector, and so on. So a vector is right here. So the totality of all vectors is essentially the totality of all the points of this brown paper, right? Because for every point, I can just connect that point to the origin and point to that point. Now, it's not just a static thing. It's not just a collection of vectors, which it is, but there is more. For example, we can add any two vectors to each other. And many of you may know how to do this. It's called the parallelogram rule. So that's the intersection point. Okay, very nice. But it's not very functional because they are, yes, the vectors are here, they're concrete, they're kind of concrete, they live here, they have this operation, but it's very difficult to work with them. So we try to make it more functional, and we do it more functional by introducing a coordinate system, what we call a coordinate system. Or in linear algebra, we call it introducing a basis. So now we come to the crucial point, okay? And the crucial point is a basis. I want to introduce a coordinate grid here. That's what I want to do. I want to just coordinate grid. And so, for example, I can use, let me use this color. So I will have two coordinate axes. So one of them, let's say, will go like this. My drawing is not particularly perfect. You know, I have taught two classes today, so please excuse my wiggly lines, but I hope the point is clear. So usually what we do, we say this is x axis and this is a y axis. We know this from school, and we know this even before we study vectors, right? We think about it rather usually as representing points. But now I want to think about more as vectors, and then you will see why. Another way to think about this, to give this two axes, is the same as to give two unit vectors along this axis. So one of them would be this one, say, and let's, you know, I don't want to overload it with notation, but it could be E1 or something. Mm-hmm. And then this would be another basis vector. So this is a basis, the unit, so the kind of unit relative to something. But we'll discuss this, what does it mean to be unit? Here's what I can do. I can represent now this vector by a pair of numbers, by simply taking the projection onto the x-axis and the y-axis, you see. So this point would be some multiple of this vector. So it would be the corresponding distance here. So it looks like 3/2, right? So this looks more like, this looks sort of like 3/2, close to 3/2. This is 1, and then you have the little increment, which looks like kind of close to 1. And this one looks like, well, let me make it a little longer, so then be 2. So that would kind of like, just kind of rounded up, okay? So then what I say is that this V1 can be represented by, we write it as a colon. As a colon of numbers. So the first, we write the first coordinate, 3/2, and then we write this 2. So that's what we do in linear algebra. But other people, sometimes people write also like this. It's your choice.
Rather than just floating on the paper now, it kind of almost has value.
That's right. It becomes a very concrete thing. It becomes a pair of numbers, okay? And it's very, very efficient because once you have that, so every vector can be written in this form. You see my V2 can also be written as a pair of numbers. My V1 plus V2 can be written as a pair of numbers. And then we can work with them because, for instance, what we're interested often is some kind of transformation of this plane, and we can feed these vectors, this vector representations, this pairs of numbers into those transformations. So this is all great, and this is very important to do that. To kind of actualize vectors by numbers. So they become actualized. You can think also of this, by the way, as a kind of a coordinate grid. So I impose a coordinate grid. So then each of them gets an address. What this is really is the address of this vector with respect to this particular coordinate grid. It's very important to realize that the vector exists even before we introduce a coordinate grid. And think about it, like you said, the ship exists even before we look at it relative to an island or another ship and so on. Or, I exist even before I have an address, before you find out what my home address is, or before I choose my home, I already exist. And likewise, a vector exists even before we introduce the coordinate grid. And it's clear why, because look, I drew it before I had any coordinate system. I drew it. It was already there on the brown paper. There is no denying the fact that it existed before, right? But what I did now, I imposed something on it. The vector, if you think about it, the vector couldn't care less what we're doing. The vector is just sitting there and enjoying its life, or whatever it is, whatever it involves, But we came, I imposed on this space, I imposed by putting this coordinate system, this coordinate grid, and with respect to this coordinate grid, I have now represented that vector by a pair of numbers. But a very important thing to realize at this point is that I had a choice. I could choose this coordinate grid in a different way. And this is what I teach my students in linear algebra. I tell them, someone else could come and construct a different coordinate system. You see, a different coordinate system. Or I could change my mind and I could create a different coordinate system. Imagine that these are the two basis vectors now going along the x and y as I drew them originally. But now imagine that it could be like this, or they could be like this, like that. And in principle, you don't even have to be perpendicular to each other, as long as they're not parallel. It is my free will, if you wish. It's my free will is in choosing that. But once you realize that there are many coordinate systems, and I have a choice of creating this coordinate system, or someone else could come. You could do it, Brady. You could make your own coordinate system. And I cannot convince you that my coordinate system is better than yours. They all are on equal footing. But now, because we now realize that this involves a certain choice, namely the choice of the coordinate system, it becomes very, very clear that this pair of numbers is not the same as the vector. And this is fine. This is how it works. But it's very important to realize that, because oftentimes we get so caught up in this process and we get so excited that, gee, we can represent a vector by a pair of numbers. And we forget the difference. And we start believing that actually there is no difference between them. But what I'm arguing is that there is a big difference, and that's what I teach my students. And this is very important. Because you see, let me put it this way. If I could ask this vector, if this vector could talk, and I could ask this vector, what are your coordinates, The vector would be like, what? What are you talking about? What coordinates? He or she doesn't know what the coordinates are. The vector is just there. It just is. I came and I tried to sort of put it in a box, if you will. I try to assign some numbers to it.
Professor, you're talking like a vector is a real thing that we applied an abstraction onto. But isn't the vector itself an abstraction to start with? A vector's not a real thing. A vector is just as imagined as the coordinate system that you imposed on it.
Yes and no, because, well, you see, they are abstractions. We are now in the world of abstraction. And my point is precisely that even in the abstract world of mathematics, you have entities, you have things, like vectors, which are not the same as numbers. How can, if you appreciate this, how can you believe that a human being is a sequence of numbers? You see what I mean? How can you believe that life is an algorithm? If you already see in mathematics, in the abstract world of mathematics, you find things which exist, which makes perfect, make perfect sense. We can work with them, like take the sum of two vectors, without any reference to coordinates or anything like this. How can you believe that that is the same as a pair of numbers? It's not. If you look closely at how we got that pair of numbers out of a vector, you realize that it involved additional choice. So every time we make this procedure, we are projecting that vector sort of onto our particular frame of reference. Let's look at this cup. Now, I can project it onto the plane, okay? I can project it onto the plane. When I project it onto the plane, I see, what do I see? I will see a disk, well, with some little thing protruding, which, you know, obviously, but more or less the disk. On the other hand, I could project it onto this whiteboard, onto this wall. What will I see? Well, if I put it in a particular way, you will just see a rectangle, okay? So let's say you look at this projection. What do you see? You see a disk. Or you look here and you see a rectangle. So you might say, what is this? Is this a disk? No. Is this a parallelogram? Again, no. Then someone else could come and say, aha, maybe it is both a disk and a parallelogram. And he or she will still be wrong because this is an entirely different thing. You see, yes, I can project it down and I can record the information and it may be some useful information, but it doesn't do justice to this whole thing. And neither does any other projection. And likewise with a vector. Think of a vector as a cup. It's an object of an entirely different nature than a pair of numbers. You can apply the same technique not only to vectors, but to other things related to this vector space. For example, what we call linear transformations. A typical example of a linear transformation would be a rotation of this brown paper around this special point, around the central point. And then, you know, I'm teaching my class. This is a kind of a funny thing. So I'm teaching my class. This is a textbook which we use. And so, I get to this point, the matrix representation of a linear transformation. It kind of hit me, you know, the matrix. You know, and so of course, you know, I remember the famous movie, and it's like, you know, remember Morpheus saying to Neo, do you want to know what it is? And that's exactly what I'm asking right now. Do you want to know what it is? Well, the matrix, on the one hand, is a very efficient way to package information, to convert objects like vectors and linear transformations into collections of numbers. The menu is not the same as a meal. You know, you can read the menu. You can go to a restaurant and you can read the menu all you want. You can even call the waiter to come to your table and explain every ingredient. You can ask the chef to come and explain the process of cooking. You can get all this information. But I'm sorry, it's not the same as eating that meal, as eating that dish, right? So it is something like this. And my point is that this matrix representation, on the one hand, can be very useful, just like our computers are very useful, algorithms are very useful. Or they can, you know, if we forget where they come from, where these programs come from, where these numbers come from, and where, when we forget the difference between the actual things they represent and the representation, that's when we create the kind of matrix that Morpheus was talking about. You know, when Morpheus said, you create the, you know, the prison for your mind. That's what we do when we forget that difference between the objects themselves and the representations. So my point is, let's use that representation. Let's use those numbers. Let's use computers, you know, to our advantage. And we are using them. But let's not forget the difference between the essence of life, so to speak, but things which just are, which we are trying to represent, and the sequences of numbers which we get as the result of that process of representation. I get asked about this all the time. You know, a famous author recently asked me, you know, he said, so you're a mathematician. Would you say that life is an algorithm? You know, people ask me, or is human just a sequence of zeros and ones? You know, you have people like Ray Kurzweil who believe that they will be able to build machines so that they could upload their mind, their brain, or whatever they got, you know, onto those machines.